Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The Modi government has appointed three new members to the PM's Economic Advisory Council: Nilesh Shah, Neelkanth Mishra and V.Anantha Nageswaran. But what is this advisory council? What is its role? And does this government really depend on it or rely on it? That's what we are going to look at today in Government Matters. Ramya Nair, who tracks the economy for The Print, is in the studio with us. Ramya, as I said in the intro, we need to first try and unravel what the PM's economic advisory is all about. But before that, can you just give us a brief of the three new members and who they are? What are the backgrounds?
So the three new members who've been appointed are Neelkanth Mishra. He's part of the Credit Sui Group. It's an investment banking firm. And he's basically looking into the India strategy for the firm. Right. Then we have Nilesh Shah. He's a well-known person in the Bombay circles. You know, he's the managing director of the Kotak Mahindra Asset Management Company, which is a mutual fund. Right. And then we have V.Anantha Nageswaran, who's the dean of the IFMR Graduate School of Business. So an interesting mix of people who have now come in.
Right. So Ramya, what is the Economic Advisory Council all about? What is its role? What kind of advice does it give? And how much does the government listen to it?
So this Economic Advisory Council was first appointed in September 2017. That was nearly 2.5 years after the Modi government initially came to power.
The first term.
And it was appointed under Vivek Debroy, who was a noted economist. So at that time, they had four members. So it was Ashima Goyal, who was with IGIDR. And then you had Ratan Roy, and then you had Shamika Ravi, who were like the members. So what's interesting is that, you know, the Economic Advisory Council was constituted just months after the whole slowdown kind of hit the Indian economy, right, because of the demonetization happened and, you know, the whole aftermath of it. So the whole feeling was that this Economic Advisory Council will provide credible inputs to the Prime Minister when it comes to, you know, how to arrest the slowdown. But what we have seen in the last 2.5 years is that this body has not been relied upon much by the Prime Minister. So the previous Economic Advisory Council under Dr. Rangarajan, when Dr. Manmohan Singh was in power, at that time, you know, the Economic Advisory Council was much more active.
So it's interesting that you say that, Ramya, that it was different under the UPA era and is different under this Modi government. If you can just give us some points to you know, sort of elaborate on that.
Yeah. So, you know, Dr. Rangarajan, when he was the head of the Prime Minister's Economic Advisory Council, the PMEAC actually used to bring out annual economic outlook reports. They used to be frequent. They used to frequently comment on, you know, the Indian economy. Then the Prime Minister at that time used to heavily rely on the PMEAC for important matters. So, you know, they bought out a report on the National Food Security Bill, which is now an act. They also bought out a report on the regulation of the sugar sector. They also bought out a report on the production sharing mechanism in the petroleum industry. So their inputs were very much a part of the policy making of the government then. In contrast, this government, this Economic Advisory Council under the Modi government, has so far notably only issued a rebuttal to the Arvind Subramanian paper, where, you know, Arvind Subramanian had talked about how India's growth rate could be much lower than what the CSO is projecting.
Right.
So they brought out this big rebuttal to the Subramanian paper.
But more than that, nothing much has been really done. So Ramya, now also it became a little bit controversial when former members Shamika Ravi and Ratan Roy turned anti-government and they publicly took a stand against the government. And then, of course, they were dropped from the Economic Advisory Council. So can you tell us something about that controversy?
So they would want to say that they didn't take a stand against the government, but probably some issues with which, you know, they oppose some issues. So we'll start with Ratan Roy. He's the head of the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy and was one of the initial members of the advisory council. So he talked about, and he was opposed to the whole idea of sovereign bond issuance. You know, he didn't like the idea of India going out and borrowing in external currencies. He pointed out how it exposes India to external and global risks.
Which
was announced in the budget by Nirmala Sitharaman. So that was one matter that he opposed. He's also been very critical of the government's fiscal handling. He's talked about on how the revenues have been over budgeted and how it is not possible for the government to meet these kind of aggressive revenue targets. Mm-hmm. So he's been critical of the whole fiscal mess, as he calls it, that India has seen itself.
Yes.
Shamika Ravi has also been critical, at least initially, of the fact that the government wasn't active enough when it came to addressing the growth slowdown. She's talked about on how you can't leave the issue of handling a slowing economy just to the finance ministry.
Right.
She obviously retracted her comments a day later, but you know, she did say that initially.
She also, in fact, spoke against the ban on vaping, if I'm not wrong.
Yes, so she was also, like, she questioned the fact that why should, you know, the government ban vaping but continue with cigarettes. She's also been opposed to the whole sovereign bond issuance. So, you know, they have been very public in their opposition to some of these
policy decisions of the government. Ramya, this government has had a history with economists, as it were. We've seen a string of economists quit, leave, etc. And we've done, in fact, a couple of government matters episodes on that as well. The new people that have been brought in, particularly Mr. Mishra and Mr. Shah, are not economists in a conservative sense, or, as you know, they're not academics per se. Is this the government's war on economists?
Interesting thing, you know, you're right when you say that, at least when it comes to Sajid Chinoy, who was appointed a few months back by the Prime Minister, and Sajid Chinoy, he's an economist with JP Morgan, and then you now have Neelkanth Mishra and Nilesh Shah. They are typically, you know, they belong either to the investment banking space or to like a mutual fund. So typically coming from the private sector and not really from an academic think tank kind of a profile that typically till now the PMEAC had seen. In one way, people would say that probably the government is more open to hearing diversity and probably hearing what the foreign investors want to say or what the markets want to say, you know, because they all represent one of these segments. So in one way, yes. But on the other way, yeah, you're right. You know, it is a marked departure from
what has been the trend
so far. Yeah.
Right. Ramya, before we close, there is also a question of conflict of interest when somebody is, say, an investment banker, or when somebody is working in the mutual funds area and they are also part of a body like the PMEAC, which is privy to a lot of information, to a lot of decision making. Is there a question there?
The question does come, you know, the conflict of interest question does arise because you have these people from the private sector who are very much, you know, who will benefit from if and how the markets, wherever in the direction the markets move. But on the other hand, you know, as we said, that the PMEAC so far has not been very active under the Modi government. So it also depends on the extent to which the Modi government relies on the PMEAC for inputs or for critical decision making. So, you know, one will have to wait and watch the level of involvement of the PMEAC going forward to, you know, make comments about the conflict of interest. On the face of it, yes, but to what extent the government relies on these members will, you know, depend. I answer that question in the future. Yeah.
Right. Well, Ramya Nair here, in fact, breaking down what the PMEAC is all about and telling us what the three new members really bring to the table and how much the Modi government actually depends on, or in this case, does not depend on, the PMEAC. Thank you for watching Government Matters. Have a good weekend. We'll be back on Monday with another episode.